So we're going to go ahead and get started here, kicking things off. I'm Fred Boyer, the organizer of Monitor SF. I'm going to tell you a story about how this group came about. About a year ago, I started to get heavily involved with observability and monitoring at my day job at turnitin.com. I used pretty much every tool out there, from Zabbix to Nagios to Datadog, Trifonis, and others. And I ended up giving a talk about some of my experiences. And before then, I had organized the San Francisco Pearl Mongers group for about 6 years. My daughter was born 2 years ago, and I took a year off that. And after I gave the talk, kind of started to get back out there once I was getting a reasonable amount of sleep. Maybe not totally reasonable still. Someone said, hey, there's not really a group focused around this topic in San Francisco. You should go ahead and start one. And so I did. And so our first meetup was back in October, where Brian Overstreet, also from Pinterest, gave a talk on their system. And it's, so far the group's been pretty well received. As it turns out, though, I found out about a month ago, there is another monitoring group in San Francisco called the San Francisco Metrics Meetup. So you should check them out also on Twitter. They got some interesting stuff going on. So anyone here go to Monitorama a couple weeks ago? Few attendees. We're very lucky to have Amy here who presented, giving the same talk here. So we're really excited about that. If anyone didn't hear about what happened at Monitorama, the power went out because of a sewer fire on the first day at 6 p.m. And so the organizers failed over the entire conference to another venue by the morning the next day, which was just an awesome feat, really impressive. Does anyone have any monitoring news to share about events going on? Does everyone know about the weekly monitoring newsletter curated by, I think, Mike Julian? He's also the SF Metrics Meetup organizer. His Twitter handle is @Mike_Julian, if I recall correctly. So that's another good resource out there. So at this point, I'll go ahead and hand it over to Ryan from Chartboost, who has graciously offered to host and provide pizza and drinks. Thanks, Ryan.
Everyone, thanks for coming. I will not take up too much time because I know that I'm not the one that you're here to see. But welcome to Chartboost. We are a monetization platform for mobile game developers. We're based here in San Francisco. We have a small office in Amsterdam as well. And basically, we're here to help mobile game developers get new users to their game. We help them monetize their games. We also provide a lot of data and analytics so that they're better equipped to make better business decisions. Being used by about 300,000 games at this point. We reach about 1 billion mobile devices around the world every month. So that brings up a lot of interesting engineering challenges given the scale that we work on. I manage our recruiting, so I would not be doing my job if I didn't mention that we are hiring. So I will not spend too much time running through every job opening that we have, but I would encourage you to check out our careers page if you're interested. And I will be in the run on the rest of the evening if you'd like to chat as well. Some logistics, the restrooms are right out that door. There is a passcode for those, which is found on that door. Wi-Fi information is up there. And that's all I've got for the evening. So enjoy the presentation.
Yourselves at home,
and now we'll
see you next time. I'm excited. Way louder? Hello? Cool. All right. I was going to say, I'm very excited that I typed the password incorrectly the first time, so I only had to see that. I'm going to have to make this. Hi everyone, I'm Amy from Pinterest. I'm here to talk about UX design and education for effective monitoring tools. Can everyone hear me okay? I can't tell if the mic is like my perspective. For anyone who didn't, who came here and maybe didn't hear in the description, today we're going to be talking about how Pinterest redesigned our internal monitoring tools to be more understandable and intuitive for our users. So I'll make sure to go through anything that doesn't make sense, but I figured, you know, we're a pretty small audience here, so if you don't understand anything you're saying, it's actually, in this case, fine to raise your hand, we can do questions throughout. I think the value of being a meetup is that the conference is having a talk, and it can be a lot more informal. So let's get into it. I'll go over what we're going to talk about first, my background, we're going to talk about Pinterest scale, so you have a sense of what kinds of, or the size of data that we're working on. We're going to talk about why everyone should care about this, regardless of what kind of company you're looking at. Then we're going to talk about two different kind, like sets of design principles. So we're going to divide it into like how you can share what you know, because most of you are like experts in your field. You know, you're people that you're able to monitor and advice. And so, how can you share that information in a way that's useful to others? And then we're going to talk about how to design what your users want, which is not always what you want. And then we're going to summarize it all so that we all go home with some good lessons. Background. So that's me. That is a picture of me when I started at Pinterest a few years ago. I'm currently on our visibility team, as you might have guessed. We cover everything from making sure metrics are being collected from all of our hosts that use AWS. That's a couple thousand hosts that we collect data from. I feel like sometimes the mic does not click. Can everyone hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna give up on this because it's freaking me out. I don't want to turn it off here. I'm gonna put it here. I don't want to pull the battery, but it's on. So I don't know how to use these things. Alright, let's talk about it. So I'm an engineer at Pinterest. I work on visibility, so we use AWS. That means we collect data from all of our thousands of hosts. We make sure that all that data is being aggregated and stored in some sort of a reasonable way, and that we're not dropping any data. Then we send all that data off to PagerDuty. We send that data to our internal monitoring tools, which I'll show you some screenshots of. And then we also allow people to search logs. And if I'm ever like dropping in volume, please just tell me to remember to keep talking loudly. So some recent things that we worked on visibility. We use tracing, so I mean Zipkin for performance. And so that's a really cool topic that we've been investigating for the past couple of months. We created some D3 data visualizations that people understand like which services depend on which other services. We created a cache for OpenTSDB data, so if some of you know, sometimes it's really hard to get your data to load in a timely manner in every time series. And every database makes that faster. And the most important thing is all of the documentation, which I'll like briefly touch on in this talk. And you can find me on all of those websites. Of course, you can find my Twitter handle there, and I'll meet you everywhere else on the internet. So I want to get talk a little about Pinterest before we move on. Pinterest is the world's first visual discovery engine. It's a place where people can discover and do what they want. And so some of our numbers include, we have 170 million monthly active users, 100 million pins, 2 billion boards, 2 million searches every month. I'm sure all these numbers are out of date, so they might be higher now, hopefully. And also we serve about 150,000 requests per second. I would say these numbers, I got them from our PR team. They told me to put a slide up about this because they heard that people like hearing these numbers. I think these numbers are boring, and so the numbers that I'd say are more exciting are the ones about our monitoring team. So first off, we use Graphite, OpenTSDB, Kafka, Storm, Spark, EOA, SuperLogic, Zipkin. I'm sure we use a ton of other tools, but I only have like 2 lines of space. So that's what we use. We log about 100 terabytes per day. We store about we have about 2.5 million metrics ingested per second into OpenTSDB. And the most important number to me is that we have over 400 engineers. And I think that's the most important number because I like to think of our engineers as customers. And so you'll see that as like a theme throughout this talk that, you know, when you're on an infrastructure team or an internal tools team, your engineers are customers and you should think of them in that way, and that we can use some of the principles when it comes to like developing product or a customer-facing company. We can apply those roles back to our own company. And so our main main internal tool that we've been developing over the past 4 years or so is StatsBoard. Fun fact is that I didn't realize StatsBoard was like a play on Pinterest boards until I think I found that like 2 months ago. So I guess no one cares about ones. I like the ones. You can look at your graphs in a dashboard format. You can explore metrics in an ad hoc format. You can just type in metrics and you'll see them on the page. And don't worry if this is something you're familiar with, we can go over what that means. And we let people create alerts in our preview or UI. And so we'll go over how we design all these tools. So next I want to talk about motivation, or why you all are actually came here on a Tuesday night, which I think is really impressive because I never go anywhere on weeknights. So the question is, why should we care about user experience? I think so a lot of times people, when you talk about user experience in the context of like an internal tool or an infrastructure tool, people say it doesn't really matter because like you don't have revenue goals, you don't have growth goals. If your product sucks, you can't, like your engineers are stuck with you. They can't go anywhere else. They, like that's all they have. And if it doesn't work, they have to figure out how to use it because it's their job. So, why wouldn't we do this instead of like working on something or working on like Gorilla or Verygay or whatever other cool project is out there that's related to monitoring? And to that, I would respond with another question, which is, have you looked at Graphite? And have you also looked at OpenTSDB? These UIs, in my mind, are terrible. I personally am like offended by the fact that the like legend right here wraps around to the other side. I think that makes no sense at all. I don't know anyone who actually uses the OpenTSDB UI. And like, I don't think any of you do either. Like, raise your hand if you've used the OpenTSDB UI.
I have.
Oh, man. You're already the point.
I don't use it. I have used it, and I try not to.
Thank you. So the point is that, you know, most people, they can, if you're at a company that might like use Datadog or SignalFX or Wavefront or other, like all these other vendors that are offering time series data, like one of their key selling points is that they have a better UX for what you're trying to do. If you're spending like more than a few minutes like using OpenTSDB's UI, you're probably upset about it. So I would say that's one big reason, like the emotional reason for why we should care about this. And then I thought about this a lot, so I want to give like three more concrete, really concrete reasons for why this matters. And the first is that if you care about how your tools are built, then that can help you prevent misunderstandings from other people on your team, or at your company. So not everyone at your company should be a monitoring expert. This is with the assumption that you're not like a company that builds a monitoring tool, in which case, yes, everyone should be a really good monitoring. But if you're like Pinterest, where you know, we have people working on international teams or growth teams or monetization teams, all those people should spend their time thinking about time series data. And so if your UIs are easy to use and intuitive, then those people they can go back to sleep. And so if your tools are easy to use, they can get back to sleep faster. And then the last idea that I want to share is the idea of data democracy, which is when there's so many people who do different things at your company, and all of them have these like questions that they want to ask, but they can't, it's not scalable for them to ask you how to figure out what they are trying to say or what they're trying to get out of the data. And so if you make it as easy as possible for them to like, independently use your data, then everyone can reach the conclusions that they're trying to get to. And I think this ties back into one of my favorite ideas from software engineering, which is that the fastest way to become a 10x engineer is to help 10 other engineers do their jobs better. And I think there's so many different ways to become a 10x engineer. I also could buy the argument that there's no such thing as a 10x engineer. Like, maybe you can code the best or something, or produce the most pull requests or something like that. But when we're in an infrastructure role where maybe our contributions aren't as visible or applicable to the rest of the company, it's really nice to know, like, you are doing like a really great job if you can make other people at your company do your jobs even better. And so I think that's my favorite definition of like what a 10x engineer is. So if we go back to this, I feel like I included this like because I thought all these things were really important to me, but all these things are like super buzzwordy and like kind of like, I'm falling asleep because like those are some big words and I don't like big words. So if you want to take something away from this talk, to take away is that UX design, especially for monitoring tools, helps people to move correctly, quickly, and independently. So that's what you should take away from this. The next thing I want to talk about your situation. I realize that not everybody builds their own internal monitoring tools. Maybe not everyone even uses the monitoring tool. So you might be thinking, like, why am I even here? I'm not Pinterest. I don't have like a tool that's like 4 years old. That's a like a time series web app. And so what I would argue is that UX applies to everything that happens at your company. And so starting with like, you know, the hierarchy of needs, you know, you can think about UX in terms of your team. Like that's the foundation of what you should be thinking about. If your team answers people's questions, but people either don't get their questions answered, or they don't have an answer completely, or the answers don't make sense, or if you make them feel bad for asking questions, whether intentionally or non-intentionally, all those things are part of the user experience of working with your team. And so what I want to emphasize here is, like, in the product sense, UX can often mean what it's like to use your product, but in the monitoring sense, it means what's the experience of working together with your team. So that's like one thing I think you should all think about, regardless of your tool situation. So even if you use like Data Hub or Wavefront or Signalfx or any of those other tools, you still think about the user and what it's like to work with your team. And then next would be documentation. And I really wanted to call this one out because if you have outdated documentation or your documentation doesn't make sense, like, you know, someone starts following the steps and like the steps just don't work on their computer anymore, those are all bad user experiences for someone trying to work with their team. And so if you have a bash script that everyone's been passing around for years and years and nobody knows how it works anymore and there's no comments, that's a part of the user as well. And then of course what I'm going to be talking about in this talk is the tools. And so that's a little bit more of a traditional UX design perspective. So I thought that would be the most fun thing to talk about. But I do want to say that tools come after you've thought about your team and after you've thought about your documentation. And then the last thing, I had like four triangles and I thought a long time about what the top triangle would be and I didn't have anything. So maybe like after you've done all this, you can think about buying Data Talk and that's what I might do. You can basically ignore that. I just didn't want three bullet points. So it's all right. This talk will be about tools, but there are so many things that we can all control that are not just the tools. So I really hope that the lessons you learned from this talk can be applied to anything else at your team, at your company, regardless of your actual situation. Does anyone have like questions or comments? Because I'm about to move into a meetup talk. Okay. Okay, so now we're going to talk about sharing what you know. So, I want to split this up to a bunch of like short lessons. So first we're going to talk about how to decide when to educate your user versus when to use your intuition. If you present someone with too much information up front, oftentimes all of it goes over their head. And so I want to give an example of this. On you all pause and think about what you think this means. So to me, when someone writes like metric is greater than 5, it's like they're writing an alert and they're trying to say, tell me when this metric is greater than 5. And that's kind of confusing because like a metric is really a bunch of data points over time. Like you might have one unique number for every second. So what does it mean to be greater than 5? And if I ask an engineer at my company, what they'd say is, oh, it's whenever, you know, you draw the line of your time series and then it's whenever it goes over 5. And you know, you might think, oh, that wouldn't work in practice because if it's going over 5, like what if it's spiking a lot, like maybe you're having like network connection issues and it's just going up and down. Do you really want to get email every time it goes over 5? And probably like the user might say, no, I don't want to get email every single time it goes over 5. I want to get email like once per incident. And so you might say, oh, well, then you don't want to alert every time it goes over 5, you just want to alert like around that time. What does that mean? How do you rigorously define that? So there's a lot of times in monitoring where people will make assumptions or they won't have thought very carefully about what they're trying to say. But you have to decide when it's the right time to explain to someone like all the theory or like thought you put together, like making it really which is like not very, it's not very clear to a layperson what aggregate series by average means. But if someone asked me, I used to like want to say, oh, it's when you're here, like right at this point, you would take the last 10 minutes, because that's around 10 minutes, you would take the 10 minutes before you would average that, and then that would mean you have a month's value, and then compare that to your threshold. And I would say that in so many words that people just look lost. Because if nobody really wants to hear all that. I even, like, at some point, I got to argument with my teammates because I wanted this to have more words and more explanation. And everyone got a look at me and said, no, nobody wants to read words right now. And so what we realized is, like, yes, it's important that people understand, but, like, the more important thing is that people would just see in this preview, or, like, it doesn't matter if people know, like, what the difference is between, like, aggregating a metric daytime series before you blur on it versus, like, whether you're going to blur on it and pass it a certain threshold. What matters is that, like, people want to know, is this going to trigger when I think it's going to trigger? And so if you give them, like, an intuitive way to, like, think about it, test it, then at least they can, like, intuitively grasp, like, the red parts are highlighting the parts that I think they should be highlighting. And just as a side comment, it's kind of really small here, but in case you were wondering, the pink means, like, the threshold was passed, but the red is when you would actually get emails of people who have been up to when they would have actually gone woken up by something versus when, like, their threshold was passed. So I thought that was kind of cool too. So the point is that if you let people, like, kind of intuitively feel out what's right, then they can get going on their own, even if they don't understand all the theory behind it. And there is a place where you can put the information that you want out there. I really like Wikis. I can write all of my feelings out in a couple of paragraphs on here and hope that someone reads it. And I realize no one really reads the Wiki, but it's there. So if you have a lot of feelings about metrics, put them on your Wiki, hope someone reads it, no one's going to read it, then everyone's happy. The second thing you should all think about is best practices, because, you know, for the most part, if you're on your monitoring team at your company, you probably have a lot of expertise about how to do monitoring the right way. And I would say the best way to present that knowledge or your knowledge to other users is to use, like, default behavior. I recently talked to an engineer at a different company, and I was like, how do you do alerts? Like, do you do alerts so that they'll notify whenever you pass a number? Do you do the averaging thing? Do you wait a couple of seconds? And these are all different valid ways to do alerting. And she was like, yeah, we have all those different kinds of options. And I asked, how does an engineer decide which one is the best one for their situation? And she said, I don't know. They just let it go. Or they just figure it out on their own. And I think that sucks. Like, why should someone spend so many minutes trying to figure out what the best thing to do is? But probably there's a general answer. Like, if you don't know what you're doing, start with this. And that's where, what's really nice is that even if a company has different ways of doing things or has specific needs, your job is to understand your company situation and then make those defaults. Like, I can't tell you what the defaults are. I'm not going to tell you that aggregating series by average works for you just because it works with interest. But the point is that you can figure it out. And so the way that you would, like, work, the way you do, like, default behavior is, you know, fill in these blanks, like, hey, 10 minutes is the best time for you. 10 minutes is good for us because it takes a little while for the TSDB to get all the data in, so we have to wait a few minutes. Checking 30 seconds is okay for our scale, but maybe you want to wait, like, every hour, you want to check every 30 minutes or something like that. And we did realize that average is the best for our case. And so if you have different needs for your company, make sure it's really easy for your users to take the knowledge that you have and just, like, get going without thinking so hard about how to do things the right way. So, and then the last thing is kind of like a cousin of the first one, which is, like, you do want to make it really easy to do the right thing, and you want to make it as hard as possible to do the wrong thing. I'll give another concrete example of this, which is on the same page, you notice that average right here is the default value, but there's another option called final point, and I kind of alluded to this, which is OpenTSDB takes a few minutes for data to come into the service. So if you really, really, really wanted to make your alert so that you get notified any time your line passes a value, then you actually have to wait a few minutes because but if you say, what's the value right now, it might be zero, and then your alert will not make any sense. So you have to wait a few minutes for all the data to come in. So a final point would be, you know, the latest, most recent data point is not always the best choice. We don't stop people from using final point if they really, really want to. I really want to use Puppy to tell people to not do it, but I don't have a good way of like discouraging people from using final point if they want to. I think the answer here is that like we bury it in the drop-down menu so that people really want and find it, but most people are okay with average and then they're not willing to like go down and open the drop-down menu. And so, yeah, you can kind of scare people away from things that you know are already not going to work. And then our next section is designing things that users will want. And first, that I think is the most important, and possibly the most traditional topic is performance. Performance is the number one thing that our users want. Like, I had a magic wand, and I could throw away everything we did for UI and just make things we could see fast. Like, if all of our time series data, like, from 3 months ago, if it could load in a second, that'd be great. And nobody would ever talk to me again, because they just all have all everything that they want. I can't do that, so that's why I have all these UI things. So I'll do a quick survey of all the things we're interested in doing on my test of performance. So on the back end, again, I'm going to go through super fast. I feel like there's an entire 45-minute talk that could be given about how to optimize like for time series data, but I'm not the person to give that talk. So let's go super fast. The role of data over a long time range. So right now we store data at like a 10-second resolution. It would be nice if like, we waited like a week and then you know started rolling that data up over like a minute or an hour, and then if we had like data from 3 months ago, maybe we could sort of like roll it up over a day, and that was same on storage and over time. We could store data in memory. I'm a big fan of the Gorilla paper. I'll put these slides up after the talk if you click on that and read the Gorilla paper. I think it's really cool. There's some like sweet math stuff I don't get. And they have this open source tool for Memory Gate, which is also really promising. Makers of time series data just get stored in memory. As I mentioned before, you can add a cache and load your data in memory, which is also cool. There's a new open source project that does exactly that with TSDB data. These are all things I recommend looking into if your systems are slow, and you want them to be not slow. But I think the really funny thing about this is, like I said, low-hanging fruit. And none of this is low-hanging fruit. It takes like a couple of months to do this. So like, why am I bringing up all this stuff that isn't exactly easy to do? And to be clear, we are working on these things, but what if you can make your performance seem faster? And that's where the front end comes in. So there's a bunch of different things you can do on the front end. Like, if a user requested like 1 day of data and they then click on the 2 days of data, you don't have to load up that 1 day of data that was already on the page again. This is something we do. No matter how many times you change the time window, it always reloads the entire data set. That's just do repeating work that you've already done. And so that's one thing you can do with Ajax, you can just load up the data that isn't on the page yet and then update rather than reloading everything. You could prevent the user from requesting data excessively. When it comes to OpenTSDB, if you send like a bajillion requests over and over, you keep refreshing, it will somehow make every single request stop responding. I don't know why OpenTSDB is that way, but if you know that those things about your system, then you know you can just stop the user from doing those things. So in our case, sometimes we have outages because too many people are using OpenTSDB at the same time. So from the stats point of view, we've been talking about whether we should just prevent the user from refreshing the page over and over. Also, it's not necessarily about refreshing the page over and over, but like if you have something like autocomplete where you're trying to autocomplete a metric and you need a query for that metric every single time someone types in a character, you might want to use like a debouncer, which is a word I learned from our front end engineer. You can stop the person from making a query every single time they type in a character. You can wait a few seconds every time they make a query. And then another thing that would be probably a good idea is that you can lazy load dashboards. So if you have a page of 20 dashboards, you can just wait and only show the dashboards are on the screen. You don't have to slow down the entire service by loading every single dashboard on the page. And as a disclaimer, to be clear, we have done all these things, but I think these are all like really cool and promising ways that you can make performance better on your service and make more things about being afraid or anxious. I think the two big reasons why people are afraid of using monitoring tools is, first of all, they're afraid that they're going to break something and or make an irreversible change. And then the second thing is that they're afraid that they're going to like lose their progress in some way. And so we wanted to address both of those kinds of fears in our UI. And so here's our graph exploration page. The most important thing that I, or the most, like my most requested feature as a user of our tools was like, I want to not lose my data every time I refresh the page. And so this is a huge, huge problem that you need to think about if you are doing anything Ajax related. If you're requesting your data through Ajax, or just, you know, not through a whole page reload, your history button is going to be broken. You can try to click back the Ajax request won't be loaded. And so, you know, in JavaScript, you do have to manually add to the history stack in order for the back button to work. And you also do have to make sure the refresh button works. And the way you make the refresh button work ideally is like you make sure this URL actually reflects what's on the page. So make sure your URLs are RESTful, make sure your back buttons work. These are all things that can break when you're using a lot of JavaScript. And that, what's really nice about this is if someone is afraid of that their data is going to go away if they like click on a new tab or if they go back, they're never going to close that tab ever again. And that's how you get people like 20 different tabs of like the same method over and over again. And that's like a terrible experience. Then you don't know what data is new, what data makes sense anymore, what you're looking for. So now that we allow people to use to refresh the page to send links to other people, which is another benefit of this, if the links work and you can just copy and paste them to the side. All these things make it easier for our users to feel like they're thinking of their tools without everything falling apart. As for the alerts page, before we built this, the only way I could test an alert was by running the alerts like program, cloning the repo, running it on their own computer, and then checking if the alert works. And if you're about to press the no-op flag, you could potentially get emailed like a ton of different times just because you're testing out an alert. And that made people really, really unwilling to test their alerts out. It was really tedious. And so, as you saw, letting people test out their alerts in a safe way where they're not going to get emailed a million times turned out to help people make alerts more. And I know people are making alerts more because now we've been growing in terms of like number of requests of PTSDB by like 10% every month since we released this, because everyone's like super excited about making alerts, and now we can handle the scaling problem. So I created the scaling box for us. It's great. And then the last thing I want to talk about is simplicity. You want to make it as easy as possible to figure out what to do. This is one of my favorite lists of all time. It's Skinner from The Simpsons. He's like asking himself, am I wrong or are the children wrong? And he, of course, concludes that the children are wrong. And I think that's a really good description of how what it's like to work in an internal tools team where you're like, did I make a good tool? No, like, if people don't like it, it's their problem. I made a great tool, everyone should use it, everyone should love it. And it's really easy to make fun of Skinner and say, I never do that. But you will all do that, I do that. And my like sad example of this is like, this is our original Graph Builder UI. It was like a notebook style, kind of like Python's Jupyter notebooks, or even just like a what's it called, a read write loop, whatever it's called, you know, PyPython.
Grapple.
Thank you, Grapple. I was like, it's a weird acronym that you can't say out loud because it doesn't sound like letters. Grapple. Is it read about print? Okay, now we have audience participation. It's great. Okay, so it's kind of like a REPL, it's kind of like a Jupyter. It's what I thought like engineers are used to this. Like you want to type in your metric and you want to see it, and then you want to type in another metric and then you want to see your history. So you know how you got to the final result and you have your history. What a great tool. It's the greatest UI ever. And everyone hated it. And I don't know why. It's really sick. Like I thought it was a really reasonable tool to build. But all the feedback I got was like people did not want history. They were like, why can't I get rid of this? Why is there no X button here? Why can't I delete things? When I send this page to someone else, why do they see all of my history too? And you know, on our side, we're like, oh, well, we thought they'd want to see the history for like how you got to the thing you got to. And you know, in this case, I don't think anyone's like wrong or right, except that you want to build a tool that makes say, I got this thing, other people don't like it, I gotta build a thing that people like. And that's how we got to, the new draft that we have showing you these slides. I forgot I had the slides, so I had to go back. The other really huge thing that I thought was okay, that some people hated, that now I've come around to, is the syntax of how we query for an MCCB metric. The really ridiculous thing about this is that you had to remember what the name of your metric was, and like sometimes autocomplete would help you, but most of the time it wouldn't help you. So hope you know what your metric is. Hope you know what all the different aggregator options are. There's like 20 of them. Hope you know what all the tags are, because they were not going to tell you. And then hope you also know that secretly you can downsample if you want to, but it's optional. And so people just had to learn this syntax and type it in all of this manually, and they hated that too. So maybe that was a part of the reason why they didn't like the logo style, because they have to type this shit. So that's garbage. And so I want to go really deeply into this. This is the new UI. It's pretty similar to Grafana if you've used that before. And things that are different in part that now you can actually see where your data is coming from. This is our data is from OpenTSDB and Graph, right? So now you can manually specify which data source they want. Before we would just guess, which is ridiculous. You can use a drop-down menu to see what all the aggregation options are. And you also know now that rate and downsample are options that exist, even if you don't have to use them. And I think this kind of ties back into what I was saying before about making default options reasonable. We know that everyone wants OpenTSDB because that's where 90% of our metrics are. We know that most people want the sum because we use AWS, that means we have 1,000 hosts to sum up the latency or error counts across all of them. Don't sum up the latency, sum up the error counts. Do not sum the latency, that doesn't make sense. We make the default options there, but they're not useful. And we also kept the option for people to go back to the old way, as in the text input way, in case before power users. I think this is actually kind of nice because secretly it's good for accessibility if you don't like clicking on things because mobility issues. If you want to type, you can type. We actually are very bad at accessibility. I'm kind of bad about that. And then you have your tags, you have a list of tags right here, so you know exactly what's available for your metric. And so all the information is there, so you don't have to think so hard about how to make a metric, how to type it out, what information you might need. And so I think a lot of people like this method more just because they don't have to think so hard about how to create a metric. So those are all the items. I think most important things you should think about when it comes to planning for your users. My thing is I would summarize this in negative feelings that people have when it comes to using tools. Because I think the most, power users of your tools are usually excited reliability engineers, and they're always angry, and they're frustrated, they're mad and slow, and they're confused because everything's really safe and feel that it's like safe and easy.
staff assembled to a point per hour or something. They find something interesting, they zoom in on it, and it turns out it's an average staff assembled, they zoom in, that peak is way higher than it looked before, and they think it's wrong, they don't understand. Do you have to explain that to them? Is your tool explain that to them in some way?
Okay, I'll repeat the question for everyone, just in case you can hear it back. The question is, how do you explain downsampling to people? And it sounds like, in your case, what downsampling means is like, I think it can be a lot of different things. So in your case, it means when you're loading up an hour of data and you actually like take it into like 10, you're chunking it into like different time intervals?
Yeah, I'm looking at weeks worth of data and I'm chunking it into hour intervals because they don't have 50,000 pixels to show 10-second intervals, so I show hour intervals. And those reduce all the peaks, those flatten out the series, and then when they zoom in, they see all the jaggies that are much more extreme. And I often run into users who don't understand that.
Yeah, I think we have the same like kind of problem at Pinterest where, like I just showed with the pixel on the screen, we do have a big option where, let's say you have like 500 pixels on your screen, and so that means you only show like 500 data points, ideally, but you have like 2,000. We let people decide like how they want to bucket that data. So whether it's the average or if they want the max per bucket or if they want the average. And in that case, I think mostly we make the default behavior somewhat reasonable so it's not too confusing. And then we allow people to change like what the bucket is so they know what's going on. I will admit, I haven't seen that problem come up too often in terms of like confusion. I think that's kind of a situation where you have to get used to like talking to your users on an individual basis. I know it's not like really scalable, but one thing I didn't cover in here is that we have a very active Slack channel where people can ask questions. And that's when you want to make sure your team is really, really responsive to explaining these kinds of things, where you have like a wiki page that explains a common question like why is my page suddenly a false spiking when I zoom in? And then you can kind of direct people towards that when it comes up for them. I think it's one of those cases where you can't tell everybody from the start what's going on in that situation because then people will be like, is that happening to me? Is downsampling ruining my life? And then it turns out downsampling wasn't helpful to them. So I think the most important thing is like be ready to tell people about it or have like a clear explanation and have it ready to go whenever it's best.
My question is, you guys are obviously doing a lot of work to improve results, but why do you use Pinterest?
Yeah, that's a totally fair question. So the question is why would Pinterest build this as opposed to using Grafana or one of the vendors I mentioned or any other tool or something open source? So I think there's a ton of different kinds of reasons here. I think the most important reason is that we started 4 years ago, 5 years ago as like a three-person modern team in Grafana and Fishnet, unless it did. I'm going to say a lot of people didn't use it back then. And so we built up this tool, and then by the time Grafana came around, the switching cost was pretty high. The other thing that I didn't really go into is that Stanford is a series of other really huge graphs that like custom applying graphs, I mean, like for number of your CPU and all this other stuff. And so we thought about like how much it would take to make all those plugins that would make Grafana work for our case and all the different features our engineers need, and then we decided it was more cost effective to stick with what we already had as opposed to switching from Grafana. I would say based on my experience with it, the experience in using Grafana is pretty great. It would be really nice if we could switch, and I think we're evaluating that really soon. I think most teams would be best served by using a open source tool or
Sorry, are you saying Grafana?
Grafana, G-R-A-F-A-N-A. It's, I think it's mainly related to PPS in some way, but I'm not sure.
Uh,
So I've heard downsampling referred to also as spike erosion.
Spike
erosion. So you kind of, you know, in a small sample, you've got a really tall spike, and then as you average that over a longer period, the spike kind of erodes smaller and smaller. But as kind of a follow-up to that, have you looked at UI for, I know Grafana 4.3 just released heat maps and histogram visualizations. I know Circonis has had that for a while. I think Wavefront is just starting to add those. Have you looked at those at all? Have any thoughts on those?
I
t-shirt. So I don't know if you work there or just like them.
No, they pay for our meetup.
Oh, nice. That's our NAB. So maybe I should do our NAB. So my thought is probably for movies just because I hear a lot of this stuff. But I feel like I'm trashing my open season. You know, I think it works pretty well. It's supported us up to 3.5 million metrics per second. So I don't think it's unreasonable.
I only ask because you mentioned that it takes a while for your data to load, and sometimes when it's a bit too often, stuff crashes. And we've also mentioned how performance is like pretty important, so it would be ideally next.
Yeah, well, I guess the question is like, is there an alternative that could handle our scale about one or like the long term? And like, we had thought about whether or not to move to something like Datadog where you are, where you can just send them your data and they'll figure it out or something like that. But then we realized, like, when in our trial, at least, like, that not even paying someone to update their prompts go away. Like, the performance is still being kind of slow, and it'll still not be able to, like, those are going to be the first thing. So I think right now, we're doing the best we can with, like, running around, like, HBase clusters and running TCP on them. But I guess I haven't evaluated enough to know whether any different tool would handle this better, or if they would all have, like, their own problems.
So you talked a little bit about what drives what you were working on as far as user experience. Have you gotten a chance to eat your own dog food and use some sort of metrics to kind of guide you in what works best? And is there anything fun or cool that you learned from this experience?
So we don't have, like, we do have metrics for how many people are going to use Snapchat, for example, but in terms of, like, dog time series numbers, in our quarterly survey, one thing I was really excited about is we have people rate a bunch of different things out of 7. And so our number, of course, like how much people like Snapsport was like 3 out of 7, which is low. So we were like one of the worst performing products in Europe. And then we moved up to 4 after a quarter of working on all these different improvements, like overhauling our documentation, overhauling it, all these different requirements, making it like somewhat more stable and reliable. And I realized that 4 out of 7 was like brand neutral, but it's compared to 3 out of 7, it's like way better. And so my hope is that as we keep doing these quarterly surveys and I ask people to take that, they'll keep going up. So that's one number I'm excited about. The mind-blowing thing is that like people keep, I feel like we've been having more and more open TCP incidents recently. And so I was like talking to people like why that might be. And I kind of think we talk about this. We get so many requests from our like alerts back end, and we get so many new dashboards and so many people using the tool now. Because it's easier to use, that it's making us have more scalability and quick problems. It's a strange problem to have because I didn't realize that like making things easier to use would make us have more users. Very obvious statement. No, it's weird because like our engineers haven't grown that much, so I just thought I would be all the same.
Thanks everybody for coming. Amy said, feel free to hang out and mingle. We've got the space for another half an hour or so. We are looking for speakers for the group, so if you've got an interesting problem you solved with monitoring or kind of want to talk about how you do monitoring your own infrastructure, just go ahead and message me on the list and we'd love for you to give a talk.